The story of the watermills of France is a very old one. We know from recent archaeological research that many mills were built on French territory as early as the Gallo-Roman period, nearly 2,000 years ago. But it was during the Middle Ages, and especially at the turn of the 12th and 13th centuries, with France's population growing rapidly, that watermills appeared all over the rivers of France. In addition to grinding grain into flour, the basis of the human nutrition, they were also used for many other traditional activities, such as oil mills, tanneries, sawmills, forges, etc. The mills allowed man to free himself from thankless and painful tasks by adding to the strength of men and draft animals that of water and then of wind. In the 18th century, nearly 100,000 watermills are listed on Cassini's map. Traditionally, there was one mill to every 1 to 3 kilometers of riverbank. In this respect, France had the largest and richest heritage of watermills of the whole of Europe, and by extension, of the whole world. At the end of the 19th century, mills were the country's foremost economic heritage, and its success, like that of other European countries, is largely due to the presence of those mills. From the end of the 19th century and the beginning of the 20th century, the Industrial Revolution, based on the use of fossil fuels, coal, then oil, would compete with this traditional activity. Although by the beginning of the 20th century, many mills were still running and providing the first public lighting by producing electricity, this fierce competition from fossil fuels, accentuated by the emergence of nuclear energy after the Second World War, made them redundant. In the second half of the 20th century, watermills would for the most part become popular holiday resorts or, with the charm of the river flowing by, much sought after real estate. Here the river Eure flows past us from behind me there. On my right is what we call a causeway, that is, a small dam whose function is to raise the water level. There are all types of mill dams. They can be made of stone or, as here, made only of mobile sluices with a gate to allow excess flow to return to the river. And to my left, we find the mill bay or course. Here, historically, there was only soil, and men have dug a long canal that brings the water to the mill. And it's the height of the fall between the upstream and downstream levels that makes it possible to produce energy. So we can see the main effect of the presence of mills. It is to raise the water level on the upstream part by creating two very different bodies of water. An upstream body of deep water that flows very slowly, and then the open water that's sucked in and that flows faster and usually much shallower. The power of a mill is characterized by two elements: the flow that the mill's able to handle and the height of the fall. Ecology was born from the legitimate concern aroused by the increasingly significant imprint of man on his environment and the retreat of wild spaces on Earth. Among the many responses to a threatened ecology, the most radical now directly opposes man to nature. This current of thought perceives the causeways of mills as developments that disturb the natural flow of rivers. In particular, small mill dams are accused by some associations of hindering or indeed preventing migratory fish from heading upriver, and even of being the cause of their disappearance. This naturalist tendency is now at the very heart of the Water Biodiversity Department of the Ministry of Ecology. The services that it's responsible for, the water agencies and the French Office for Biodiversity, have especially since the turn of the century been advocating the destruction of mill reservoirs in the name of the renaturalization of watercourses. In the 2000s, the LEMA Aquatic and Water Environments Act in the name of so-called ecological continuity, enforced those rights of migratory fishes and sediments that some dams had compromised. This legitimate wish was to be enshrined in law through Article L21417 of the Environmental Code. This clause requires that river works owners manage, maintain, and equip the works so as to ensure that migratory fish may cross their structures. As part of their aid program to financially support this obligation, the water agencies added a further clause that called for the destruction of river structures, in particularly the thousands of mill reservoirs. The doctrine of renaturalization by destruction, although absent from the law itself, was to enter into practice by means of these aid programs. In line with the naturalistic doctrine of return to natural flow, this destruction would be the subject of almost full financing by the water agencies in all French water basins. The aid for equipping these works, the only ones provided for by law, would be limited to 30 to 60% of the costs of developing the reservoirs. Many mill owners, unable to finance half of the sometimes heavy developments required by the state, were pushed to agree to the destruction of their mills, fully financed by the authorities. The Seine Normandie Water Agency even made the equipment aid only eligible if the mill could not be destroyed. The law was thus diverted in favor of a doctrine of destruction, whose foundations are not the subject of any scientific consensus, as shown by the many studies and data published on the website hydroxois.org, as well as in the recent book by Professors Lévesque and Bravard, published in April 2020. In this work, the authors describe the policy of destroying small mill dams as religious. To quote Christian Lévesque, Emeritus Research Director of the IRD, former Director of the CNRS Environment, Life and Society Program, and specialist in aquatic ecosystems, "The current view of some environmentalists who think that everything that has been made by the hand of man must be destroyed leads to errors and aberrations." This policy of destruction was to be particularly rampant on migratory fish rivers in the Normandy and Nord-Pas-de-Calais departments, but also throughout France. A map of ecological continuity restoration operations carried out by the Artois-Picardy Water Agency reveals that 3/4 of the mills involved in ecological continuity have been destroyed. To date, we estimate that between 3,000 and 5,000 small water dams have been destroyed using public funds in the last 10 to 15 years. This policy of destroying several centuries of heritage is unique in our history. This is a very old mill that was previously used for tanning skins. In 1952, few administrations cared about the mills. And then, around the 1980s, they, and in particular Onema, became interested in them and applied pressure by doubting their legitimacy. So unless they had special authorization, mills had to be removed. In Normandy, this policy was taken so far that, in addition to the 300 mills destroyed, about a dozen mills that were small producers of hydroelectricity were bought from their owners by fishing federations or municipalities with 100% subsidies from the water agency in order to be destroyed. This happened despite all the power transition laws. The cost of the 10 purchase mills to be destroyed came to about 15 million euros. However, mills are not at the origin of the disappearance of migratory fish, and for the large majority of them, not even a significant obstruction to getting upstream. Louis Roule, at the beginning of the 20th century, the first French naturalist to study the disappearance of salmon from the Seine Basin, concluded that it was the consequence of the construction of new dams of significant height and the pollution of Paris waters. He added, with regard to traditional mills, dams, the old small dams were not very harmful. Being low, built-in, inclined planes, they could prevent any rise during periods of low water, but not in floods or medium water. The mills were covered with a runoff sufficient for the passage of fish, and the current over their inclined surface was not strong enough to prevent the salmon from jumping. This is in line with the recent work of Chanceau and collaborators in 1999, who tagged 100 salmon and for 3 years observed them crossing 31 mill causeways. Structures up to 1.5 meters high and not equipped with fish ladders are all crossed in less than 24 hours. Also, the scientific committee of the French Biodiversity Office, the OFB, admits that only 10% of the river dams are a problem to ecological continuity and must be equipped. More recently, in 2007, the scientist Ovidio and his team set the bar at 1.80 meter for trout and grayling, provided that a pit exists at the bottom of the structure. 90% of French mills have small causeways with a height of between 1 meter and 2 meters, which roughly corresponds to the jumping capacity of salmon or trout. In this regard, there is no correlation between the collapse of the presence of migratory fish, which began during the first industrial revolution and accelerated from the second half of the 20th century, and the presence of the nearly 100,000 watermills that were counted in the middle of the 18th century. At that time, as the academician Duhamel de Monceau describes very precisely in his famous Traité de Pêche, the rivers of France present an abundance of fish of all species, including salmon and other migratory fish that are widely caught, and in particular in the causeways of mills. By 1900, 100,000 salmon were still going up the Loire. In the 1960s, the silver eel was still classified as a pest on most French rivers because of its excessive abundance. And in 1990, another 700,000 to 1 million shad fish lived in the rivers of Aquitaine. All these species have almost disappeared from our rivers in the last century and decades. According to a recent article in Le Monde, between 1970 and 2016, 76% of migratory fish disappeared in the world. Because of watermills? According to the public authorities in charge of water policy, the thousands of small mill dams have disturbed the wild nature, in particular by preventing the ascent of migratory fish. Here is a diagram showing on the left a river with its stages of small mill dams and on the right a river without any dams, such as the proponents of wild rivers wish to reconfigure them. However, this pseudo-naturalistic vision, where water would flow without being dammed up at all, from the source to the sea, stumbles over one major fact: the existence of the beaver. Long before our ancestors erected tens of thousands of small mill dams to level our waterways, the beavers had been doing just that for millions of years. According to naturalists, the beaver disappeared from France around the year 1000 because of its excessive hunting, precisely at the time when our ancestors were building by their thousands mills with small dams similar in height to those of the beavers. According to the various scientific studies which compare the succession of beaver dams to small human structures, like those of mills, their effects are globally similar. In 2017, the scientist Ecker and his team noted that they have a comparable effect, with a clear convergence of both their biological and their biochemical effects. Similarly, the research of Hart and his team established in 2002 that small human and beaver dams have in general the same ecological functions. In this regard, American and Canadian scientists are full of praise for the positive effects of small beaver dams on issues related to water administration. Water retention, the slowing down of flows, the dampening of flood phenomena, diversification of environments, groundwater recharge, maintenance of abundant aquatic spaces during the dry seasons, and, as a result, the improvement of water quality through the phenomenon of denitrification. By ignoring the ancient reality of wild rivers and the fundamental role of thousands of small beaver dams on their ecology, the sorcerer's apprentices, bent on destroying mill reservoirs, will create, from scratch, a perfectly artificial river where the waters flow from the source to the sea at high speed and with all the deleterious effects that this implies. Drying of the rivers during dry seasons, destruction of aquatic environments, acceleration of water rises during heavy rains, land erosion, lowering of groundwater levels, damage to riverside buildings, not to mention the loss of a unique world heritage, as well as of significant potential for the development of renewable energies. The Mayenne region paid the heaviest price of all French departments in the destruction of its small dams. Nearly 200 of them were destroyed in the space of 10 years. On the Le Vicoin River, 24 of the 25 small mill dams have been destroyed in just a few years. The river is now almost dry every summer. No more water, and therefore, no more fish.
We saw that when the river has no more water in the summer,
the fish have trouble staying around, so we have too few fish to really attract fishermen anymore. We used to have mostly carp, pike, perch, chub, and also a lot of minnows. But now there's only poor fishing seasons. This decline in traditional water levels, in addition to the loss of resources it represents, has other harmful effects, in particular on riverside buildings. The reservoirs, which were far upstream, were filled in with stones and small rocks. What was going on? The water of the moats suddenly dropped by a whole meter, causing major damage at the foot of the towers and the bottom of the walls. The owner was forced to do several works to compensate for this drop in water. So what's happening? At that time, there were very, very few foundations. What for? Because it all rested on the rock where the buildings sat on stakes. Piles, obviously, are moisture absorbing. So what happens when you lower the water is that the piles sink and you start to get major damage. And what's more, the towers start to tilt outwards. We can't allow that. We can't let that happen without reacting. But what about the effect on migratory fish as a result of this destruction? These tables are taken from the counting stations of migratory fish on three Norman coastal rivers in Calvados, where many mills have been destroyed in the last 10 years. On the Orne, the destruction of mill reservoirs began in 2012 with the L'Enfermé mill and the Maison Rouge mill, and accelerated in 2015 and 2016. However, there is not an increase, but a collapse of migratory fish species as a result of this destruction. The same goes for the River Vire, where destruction began in 2015, as well as for the River Touque. In addition to a drying up of bodies of water and a general acceleration of rates of flow, there is also, where the destruction has been the greatest, a collapse of migratory fish species. How can this phenomenon be explained? The answer's even right there in Wikipedia, under Beavers and Their Dams. As we've already said, scientists have established that the succession of small beaver dams has overall the same effect as that of small human dams. With regard in particular to their effects on migratory fish populations, especially salmon, we read there that small dams and their ponds logically benefit stillwater and warm water species, but counterintuitively, also the salmon family. The English Wikipedia site, which includes many scientific studies on this subject, explains this phenomenon in simple terms. Small dams, while retaining large bodies of water in the summer when rainfall is low, are essential for the development and growth of young salmon and trout. In a temperate climate, such as that of the Northern Hemisphere, including France, the excess of water during winter is followed by a summer water shortage. However, without the presence of reservoirs formed by small beaver dams or small mill dams, in the summer many rivers would dry up, rivers like the Vicoin. Without those water supplies, neither freshwater nor migratory fish can survive. One last point deserves to be emphasized. Small beaver dams, like small mill dams, by retaining large bodies of water and slowing down flows, implement a process called water denitrification, namely a reduction in levels of nitrate and its derivatives in our waters, an excess of which is responsible for eutrophication, those tides of green algae. The phenomenon of self-purification of water reservoirs is described by a unanimity of French and international scientific studies. The scientist Monsieur Pinet and his team in a 2017 study conclude on this subject that, in general, everything that makes it possible to slow down the flow of water in the river and to promote exchanges between the river and the sediments, whether it be the presence of thresholds and meandering courses, secondary channels or ice jams, also promotes the purification of nitrogen by denitrification.
Thus, the destruction of thousands of small dams not only has the effect of drying up the watercourse in the summer season,
but also of aggravating the state of pollution in our waters by nitrates and their derivatives. This document, produced by the Department of Agriculture of Canada, Positive Effect of Small Dams and Reservoirs, is the exact opposite of the policy now pursued in France. It recalls that, in addition to their role in water retention and dampening flood phenomena, small reservoirs play an indisputably positive role in lowering the nitrogen and phosphorus concentrations that end up in watercourses. It therefore encourages the creation of these reservoirs, whereas France promotes the destruction of its own.
Ça, c'est la turbine Kaplan simple réglage qu'on a installée. C'est un fabricant français qui nous l'a proposé.
This is the Kaplan turbine that we installed.
It was a French manufacturer who proposed it to us. It's a machine where water just goes through and which is driven by a propeller, more or less like a boat propeller. The blades can be adjusted to optimize its operation, and its propellers, in turning, will drive an axis that rotates a large black pulley, which then drives the generator and produces totally green current. Here is the Sagebien wheel that we've started up again. We thought it very important to restore our heritage at the same time. We really wanted it to work and to produce energy with it. As part of the laws to fight the effects of climate change, our federations have made known to Parliament all these data and the reality of the essential benefits of thousands of small mill dams on the management of our waters. All the groups supported and voted for an amendment to clarify Article L214-17 of the Environmental Code, excluding the possibility of destroying small mill dams as part of an ecological continuity. In the same way that a destructive ecological policy was being promoted and financed by the authorities in charge of water policy for the last 15 years, the French Parliament wanted to replace the ecological conservation and enhancement of mill reservoirs in accordance with the law, and in particular with regard to the preservation of the country's water resources. I would also like to draw attention to the destructive ecological continuity, in particular when it comes to the thresholds on rivers or at mills that were created by our ancestors, who were sensible people who believed that certain thresholds do in fact allow the regulation of the flow of water, and also make it possible to create bodies of water that can survive periods of low water and which are the only places where fish can find refuge in periods of drought. This is evident in the dry rivers we see today. Ladies and gentlemen, all these amendments, which vary in their nature as to their origin, raise a fundamental question. Should the water reservoirs created by watermills be abolished? So we're told, yes, we must remove them because they're an attack on continuity and prevent the fish from going up the rivers. Ladies and gentlemen, is this true?
Mes chers collègues, est-ce que c'est vrai?
Ministers, in line with my fellow members, this amendment aims to preserve the watermills from planned destruction. This destruction is environmental nonsense. These mills have been present on our territory for several centuries, yet they continue to be blamed for the disappearance of wildlife, even though it only began a few decades ago. As we all know, this disappearance and the lack of reproduction of the fish in our rivers is mainly due to the quality of the water. Regarding the mills, our country is fortunate to have such a vast heritage. These mills are all along our rivers. It's an ancient heritage from the 14th, 15th, 16th and 17th centuries. It's a heritage tended by families and owners who are often passionate about it. Yet sometimes, strange as it may seem, some people wish to destroy these small dams in the name of so-called ecological continuity. This heritage, however, provides us with a water reserve. As Philip Mayer has pointed out, it produces carbon-free electricity, equivalent to the consumption of 1 million people. It matters whether we like it or not. And this heritage is threatened by an administration that, along with the regional environment departments, has become very militant against the mills, and sometimes even when giving public funding, which they believe could legitimately be assigned to other tasks. Our country is now riddled with pockets of drought that the public is not yet aware of, since it doesn't understand that water stress is no longer an exotic business that only happens in faraway lands. It's a problem right here and now in France, and a growing one. As you well know, when we've seen Ireland rationing water for part of the year, we understand that climate change is already causing effects that must be addressed before long. For my own part, I'd like the map of the regions to correspond to the map of the water agencies, and that everything else can be based on the path of the water. Employment, agriculture, travel, and thus they'll all have a common route. And more mills, because to have 100% renewable energy, we'll have to build thousands of mills.
Nous devrons construire pour passer à 100% d'énergie renouvelable.
Jean-Luc Mélenchon has spoken of this magnificent 12th century mill in La Guépie, which is in my constituency. There's another one, built at the time of the French Revolution, where you want to destroy the threshold, although it's existed since the 12th century and since the French Revolution, and that it has never altered the rivers. That's the reality. Destroying our thresholds, sluices and weirs, despite all the heritage, agricultural and tourism benefits, also has ecological consequences in an environment where the balance between fauna and flora has been established over time. To destroy our small dams is to considerably reduce bodies of water at a time when water storage is becoming strategic against a backdrop of climate change. But it's also accelerating the speed of flow with an impact on groundwater, on related wetlands or during floods. And you've all heard about the famous Cévennes episodes. Minister, ladies and gentlemen, Over the past two summers, our country has experienced particularly worrying droughts. In 2019 and 2020, nearly 90 departments, almost all of our territory, were the subject of a drought order and of severe restrictions on water use that penalized our farmers and fellow citizens. The report of the 11th of December 2019 on water policy, submitted by our colleagues Le Clabart and Contin, concludes that almost a third of the territory of the European Union is already exposed to water stress. The dangers associated with drought from the lack of water or from flooding are likely to increase in the coming decades. However, while our territory is subject to an increasingly significant lack of water, hundreds of reservoirs are destroyed each year with public funds as part of so-called ecological continuity policies. To date, between 3,000 and 5,000 water reservoirs, in particular mill reservoirs, have been destroyed as part of the aid programs of the water agencies. However, the law has exclusively provided for the management, maintenance and equipment of these works in order to fulfill ecological continuity obligations, and not their destruction. And I rely on Article L214.17 of the Environmental Code to say this. How can we explain to our fellow citizens in such a context of recurrent water stress that the state encourages and finances the destruction of water reservoirs? The 3,000 to 5,000 already destroyed represent a loss of tens of millions of cubic meters of fresh water removed from our territory, which can no longer feed our aquifers as it has done for centuries. On the occasion of this amendment, I would like to pay tribute to the action of elected representatives and everyone in the field who's acting for water, for this common good, and all those who share the objective of restoring ecological continuity, which consists in ensuring the preservation of biodiversity and the good health of our water. Achieving this, though, is a source of complexity and tension, and there are many misunderstandings between state services and the owners of hydraulic works.
In fact, it's the destruction and not the equipment of these works that is being privileged.
I would just like to say three things. The first is, we're in the Senate. We have all lived long in our territories, and we have examples of what we've lived, what we've known, what has existed, and what has been done in our territories. For my part, coming from a small village, I have a small stream that has its source barely 1 kilometer from my home, and on this source there were two starch factories. There was a weaving mill, and there was also a mill with a turbine. I'm a fisherman in every sense of the word. I've always caught both trout and crayfish all along the river. And I'm serious when I say that because the life of a river is a very complex thing, and what our elders did and our history, because we don't just come from nowhere, has effectively allowed us to preserve this aquatic wealth. To support the wish of our Parliament to preserve and enhance the thousands of French watermills, the project of the two French federations of watermills and the Association of Riverside Dwellers of France is to engage in the valorization of both energy and the environment through a major plan of promotion of the mills. The recommissioning of thousands of watermills represents a renewable energy production potential equivalent to the annual electricity consumption, apart from heating, of 1 million homes, according to the European Restore Hydro study. Similarly, knowledge of the purifying effect of water reservoirs, in particular on excess nitrates and phosphorus, as well as pesticides, offers interesting prospects. As everyone knows, the problem of our rivers lies in the excessive pollution of our waters.
Recent reports highlight France's significant delay in this field, which the doctrine of destruction partly explains.
Thanks to the voting in Parliament of the Mills Amendment, we can now call on our elected representatives, our administrations, and our river unions to support our associations locally in the accomplishment of this project. The watermills of France are a valuable tool in the fight against the effects of climate change. Let us preserve them. Let us value them.